In my craft or sullen art, exercised in the still night, when only the moon rages and the lovers lie abed with all their griefs in their arms, I labor by singing light, not for ambition or bread, or the strut and trade of charms on the ivory stages, but for the common wages of their most secret heart. Not for the proud man apart from the raging moon I write on these spindrift pages, nor for the towering dead with their nightingales and psalms, but for the lovers, their arms round the griefs of the ages, who pay no praise or wages, nor heed my craft or art.
I like people telling me about their childhood, but they'll have to be quick or I'll be telling them about mine. Because there is, in most people, a need to share enthusiasm. A need which is often expressed in behavior known, nicely, as showing off. It's a need common to actors, poets, politicians, and other trapezists. I was born at the beginning of the First World War in a large Welsh town by the side of a long and splendid curving shore, Swansea. An ugly, lovely town, so it was and is to me, crawling, sprawling, slummed, jerry-villaed and smug-suburbed, with its blackened monuments of civic pride, its impressive gasworks and slaughterhouse, its police station, dark as a helmet, dry as a summons, sober as Sunday, with its pubs waiting for Saturday night, as an over-jolly girl waits for sailors, its packed streets stale as railway station sandwiches, and its museum, which should have been in a museum. This sea town was my world. Outside, a strange and mountain Wales with wild names like peals of bells in the darkness, and mountain men clothed perhaps in the skins of animals, and always singing. Beyond that lay England, which was London, and the country called the Front, a country to which only young men travelled. When I was small, the only front I knew was the little lobby inside our front door, and I could not understand why so many people never returned from there. Oh, but later I grew to know more and carried a wooden rifle in Coom Donkin Park, the park where, later still, I was to endure, with pleasure, the first agonies of unrequited love and the first slow boiling in the belly of a bad poem. The park was the place to tell your secrets. If you did not have any, well, you invented them. Even now, occasionally, I dream of one secret I had. Oh, when I was very small, I dream that I say to the other boys in my class, at last, I have a real secret. I can fly. And when they laugh at me, I flap my arms like a large, stout bird and slowly leave the ground. Oh, Dracula in a school cap, level with the upper windows of the school, waving my cap so that the mistress of the piano screams and the metronome falls with a clout and there is no more time. And I fly over the chimneys of my town, over the yellow seashore, and the stone-chasing dogs, and the old ship's captains, and the singing sea. The memories of childhood have no order and no end. But when you are a writer, you can put them into a sort of order and make stories out of them. That is what school exercise books are for. And always I've been at it, making stories, ever since my first one, told to myself in the warm, safe island of my bed, with my sleep filthy midnight town, flowing and rolling round the house. And me, suddenly aware of me, myself, in the exact middle of a living story. And my body was my adventure. And my name. A story with a demon, that first one was. All wings and hooks who clung to my hair as I battled up and down Wales after a tall, wise, golden, royal girl. From Swansea Convent. Then there were the stories I told to myself when I was kept in after school for being a bad boy, such as pouring water into little girls' galoshes. When I sat alone in the twilight of the empty classroom, and heard above me the distant, terrible, sad music of the late piano lesson, a snub-nosed storyteller lost in his own adventures and longing to be home.
To begin at the beginning. It is spring, moonless night in the small town, starless and Bible black, the cobbled streets silent and the hunched quarters and rabbits wood limping invisible down to the slow black, crow black fishing boat bobbing sea. The houses are blind as moles, though moles see fine tonight in the snouting velvet dingles, or blind as Captain Cat there in the muffled middle by the pump and the town clock, the shops in mourning, the welfare hall in widow's weeds, and all the people of the lulled and dumbfound town are sleeping now. Hush! The babies are sleeping. The farmers, the fishers, the tradesmen and pensioners, cobblers, schoolteacher, postman and publican, the undertaker and the fancy woman, drunkard, dressmaker, preacher, policeman, the webfoot cockle women, and the tidy wives. Young girls lie bedded soft or glide in their dreams with rings and trousseaus, brides mated by glowworms down the aisles of the organ-playing wood. The boys are dreaming wicked, or of the bucking ranches of the night and the jolly rogered sea. And the anthracite statues of the horses sleep in the fields, and the cows in the byres, and the dogs in the wet-nosed yards, and the cats nap in the slant corners, or lope sly, streaking and needling on the one cloud of the roofs. You can hear the dew falling, and the hushed town breathing. Only your eyes are unclosed to see the black and folded town fast and slow asleep. And you alone can hear the invisible starfall, the darkest before dawn minutely dew-gray stir of the black dab-filled sea, where the Arethusa, the Curlew, the Skylark, Zanzibar, Rhiannon, the Rover, the Cormorant, and the Star of Wales tilt and ride. Listen. It is night. Moving in the streets, the processional salt, slow musical wind in Coronation Street and Cockle Row. It is the grass growing on Llareggub Hill, dewfall, starfall, the sleep of birds in Milkwood. Listen, it is night in the chill, squat chapel, hymning in bonnet and brooch and bombazine black, butterfly choker and bootlace bow, coughing like nanny goats, sucking mintos, 40 winking hallelujah. Night. In the four ale, quiet as a domino. In Ockie Milkman's lofts, like a mouse with gloves. In Dye Bread's bakery, flying like black flour. It is tonight in Donkey Street, trotting silent with seaweed on its hooves, along the cockled cobbles, past curtained fern pot, text and trinket, harmonium, holy dresser, watercolors done by hand, china dog, and rosy tin tea caddy. It is night, neddying among the snuggeries of babies. Look, it is night, dumbly, royally winding through the coronation cherry trees, going through the graveyard of Bethesda with winds gloved and folded and dew-doffed, tumbling by the sailors' arms. Time passes. Listen. Time passes. Come closer now. Only you can hear the houses sleeping in the streets in the slow, deep, salt and silent, black, bandaged night. Only you can see in the blinded bedrooms the combs and petticoats over the chairs, the jugs and basins, the glasses of teeth, thou shalt not on the wall, and the yellowing dicky bird watching pictures of the dead. Only you can hear and see behind the eyes of the sleepers the movements and countries and mazes and colors and dismays and rainbows and tunes and wishes and flight and fall and despairs and big seas of their dreams. From where you are, you can hear their dreams. Captain Cat, the retired blind sea captain, asleep in his bunk in the sea-shelled ship-in-bottle ship-shaped best cabin of schooner house, dreams of...
Never such seas as any that swamped the decks of his SS Kidwelly, bellying over the bedclothes and jellyfish slippery, sucking him down salt-deep into the Davy Dark, where the fish come biting out and nibble him down to his wishbone, and the long drowned nuzzle up to him.
Remember me, Captain?
You're dancing, Williams.
I lost my step in Nantucket.
Do you see me, Captain, the white bone talking? I'm Tom Fred, the donkey man. We shared the same girl once. Her name was Mrs. Probert.
Rosie Probert, 33 Duck Lane. Come on up, boys. I'm dead.
Hold me, Captain. I'm Jonah Jarvis, come to a bad end. Very enjoyable.
Alfred Pomeroy Jones, sea lawyer, born in Mumbles, sung like a linnet, crowned you with a flagon, tattooed with mermaids, thirst like a dredger, died of blisters.
This skull at your ear hole is?
Curly Bevan, tell my auntie it was me that pawned the Ormolu clock.
Aye, aye, Curly.
Tell my missus, no, I never.
I never done what she said, I never.
Yes, they did.
And who brings coconuts and shawls and parrots to my Gwen now?
How's it above?
Is there rum and lava bread?
Bosoms and robins?
Concertinas?
Ebenezer's bell?
Fighting and onions?
And sparrows and daisies?
Chitlers in a jam jar?
Buttermilk and whippets?
Rockabye baby?
Washing on the line?
And old girls in the snug?
How's the tenors in Dowlais?
Who milks the cows in my Squin?
When she smiles, is there dimples?
What's the smell of parsley?
Oh, my dead dears.
From where you are, you can hear in Cockle Row in the spring moonless night, Miss Price, dressmaker and sweet shopkeeper, dream of...
her lover. Tall as the town clock tower, Samson syrup gold-maned, whacking-thighed and piping hot, thunderbolt-braced and barnacle-breasted, flailing up the cockles with his eyes like blow lamps and scooping low over her lonely, loving, hot water bottle body.
Bevanoy Price.
Mr. Margedrath.
I am a draper mad with love. I love you more than all the flannelette and calico, candlewick, dimity, crash and merino, tussor, creton, crepon, muslin, poplin, ticking and twill in the whole cloth hall of the world. I have come to take you away to my emporium on the hill, where the change hums on wires. Throw away your little Welsh bedsocks and your Welsh wool knitted jacket. I will warm the sheets like an electric toaster. I will lie by your side like the Sunday roast.
I will knit you a wallet of forget-me-not blue for the money to be comfy. I will warm your heart by the fire, so that you can slip it in under your vest when the shop is closed.
Mavannoy, Mavannoy, before the mice gnaw at your bottom drawer, will you say...
Yes, Mog, yes, Mog, yes, yes, yes.
And all the bells of the tills of the town shall ring for our wedding.
It was my 30th year to heaven, woke to my hearing from harbour and neighbour wood and the mussel pool and the heron priested shore.
The morning beckon with water praying and call of seagull and rook, and the knock of sailing boats on the net-webbed wall. Myself to set foot that second in the still sleeping town and set forth. My birthday began with the water birds and the birds of the winged trees flying my name above the farms and the white horses. And I rose in rainy autumn and walked abroad in a shower of all my days. High tide, and the heron dived as I took the road over the border, and the gates of the town closed as the town awoke. A spring full of larks in a rolling cloud, and the roadside bushes brimming with whistling blackbirds, and the sun of October, summery on the hill shoulder. Here were fond climates and sweet singers suddenly come in the morning, where I wandered and listened to the rain, ringing wind blow cold in the wood far away under me. Pale rain over the dwindling harbor, and over the sea-wet church, the size of a snail with its horns through mist, and the castle brown as owls. But all the gardens of spring and summer were blooming in the tall tales beyond the border and under the larkful cloud. There could I marvel my birthday away, but the weather turned round. It turned away from the blithe country, and down the other air on the blue altered sky streamed again a wonder of summer with apples, pears, and red currants. And I saw in the turning so clearly a child's forgotten mornings when he walked with his mother through the parables of sunlight and the legends of the green chapels and the twice told fields of infancy, that his tears burned my cheeks and his heart moved in mine. These were the woods, the river and sea, where a boy in the listening summertime of the dead whispered the truth of his joy to the trees and the stones and the fish in the tide. And the mystery sang alive, still in the water and singing birds. And there could I marvel my birthday away, but the weather turned round. And the true joy of the long dead child sang, burning in the sun. It was my 30th year to heaven, stood there then in the summer noon, though the town below lay leaved with October blood. Oh, may my heart's truth still be sung on this high hill in a year's turning.
Early, one momentous morning, in 5 Coom Donkin Drive, Swansea, I padded barefoot downstairs, opened the breakfast room door, lit the gas. The mantelpiece clock, between hollow, mock ebony pawing horses, showed 5 to 2. Upstairs, the family breathed securely. My sister in the box room, my father in his one dream, turning over the bills of the month, and my mother mopping and polishing through a wood of kitchens. 3 strangers I had known all my life. I looked at the long string of snapshots of my mother propped against the cut glass vase with the permanent flowers. A photographer under a dicky bird hood had snapped her as she tittered down Chapel Street, chirping good morning to the shopping bag she knew. Your photograph has been taken. Immortalized in a moment, she shopped forever along the mantelpiece. I took up the string of snaps, folded them, and tore them to pieces. The photograph of my sister. On the table, my father's papers, exam papers in history, carefully marked and damned in his schoolmaster writing. I took a lump of coal and I remarked them. History is lies. Take George Washington. Take Queen Elizabeth. Go ahead. Take Alice Phillips, the headmaster's daughter. Take Mr. Parsons, the maths master. Tell him his wife has been seen coming out of the Bayview Hotel, piggyback on a drunken sailor, catching pennies in her garters. It's as true as history. I opened the door of the china pantry. The best plates shone in rows. Finger bowls, the heirloom moustache cup. Quietly, I cracked two saucers together. The afternoon tea service was as brittle as biscuits. In 5 minutes, quietly, I'd broken the set. Let all the girls in snoring Swansea walk in and see me now. Shoo them in! I tore up the bills, wrenched apart my mother's white crochet work, and wedged it up the chimney. These, I said to myself in the mirror, these are such small things. You should smash the windows and stuff the cushions with the glass. But you won't, I said. You're afraid she'll cut her hand. I felt the tears drop onto my pyjamas. I put out my tongue and tasted them. They're salt, just like in my poems. I climbed back to my bedroom. Girls, come down into my arms. This morning I'm going away by the 7:15 train. Come down quickly, the milkmen are waking. By 6 o'clock, I could hear the family on the landing. Nancy, you put his new safety razor in there. Where's his hairbrush? Where's his hairbrush? Don't, I prayed, don't let her look in the china pantry. I went down. My mother was boiling my egg in the kitchen. Sleep well. She brushed my collar as I ate. When you get to London, get yourself a nice room, not too central. And don't have an Irish landlady. Don't forget to look under the wallpaper for insects. I saw myself knocking at a house just off Piccadilly Circus. And the door opened by an Irish landlady, not more than 21. Good morning, madam. Have you a cheap room? Cheaper than sunshine to you, Danny boy. Bugs be got all over the walls. Praise be to God. The taxi drew up. All down Cwmdonkin Drive corners of blinds were lifted. My sister kissed me on the forehead, said my mother. Oh, you're kissing the editor of the Times now? Not quite yet, said my father. Rungs of the ladder. Looked away. The taxi was off. I saw three strangers waving. Pulled down the blind.
Do not go gentle into that good night. Old age should burn and rave at close of day. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. Though wise men at their end know dark is right, because their words had forked no lightning, they do not go gentle into that good night. Good men, the last wave by, crying how bright their frail deeds might have danced in a green bay. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. Wild men who caught and sang the sun in flight and learned too late they grieved it on its way, do not go gentle into that good night. Grave men near death who see with blinding sight, blind eyes could blaze like meteors and be gay, rage, rage against the dying of the light. And you, my father, there on the sad height, curse, bless me now with your fierce tears, I pray. Do not go gentle into that good night. Rage, rage against the dying of the light.
I want you, lady or gentleman, to imagine that you are an English novelist. After years of typewriting toil, ping, 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 ting-a-ling, ping, 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 ting-a-ling, you have finished yet another book, which drifts into the London literary pond and turns slowly, surely, unexpectedly, respectably, into a success. Book society choice. Quite enchanting, Elizabeth Bowen. I can recommend it thoroughly, J.B. Priestley. You are mildly delighted and ditto intoxicated somewhere between Bloomsbury and Mayfair by a couple of literary lunches preceded by cooking sherry. And you begin to dream in your moony English writer's way of retiring to Dymchurch in Kent and keeping bees. But in the meantime, your novel has been published in the United States of America. And into your study one day, there bursts your New York agent, trigger man, and armed thug. You're a smash hit, ba 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 ba. Your masterpiece is killing them over there, ba 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 ba. You gotta come over and make a personal appearance, bang, bang, bang. It seems that you are to go round the United States lecturing to women. And you, who have never dared lecture a mouse, never mind a woman, you find yourself wafted across the ocean, first class, in the plush bowels of the Queen Mary, with a list of engagements as long as a New York menu or a half hour with a book by Charles Morgan. And when you set out from New York on your tour as a lecturing celebrity, it does not dawn on you yet that you are one of an army. For the map of the United States is black with women's clubs. Across the continent and back, for months on end, there streams and sings for its heady supper a dazed procession of exhibitionists, novelists, economists, sociologists, existentialists, histrionic publicists, physicists with nuclear missions, rhetorical theologians, theoretical historical hoddy-doddies, hoddy-doddy an obsolete word meaning a short, dull, dumpy person, theoretical historical hoddy-doddies, balletomanes, ulterior decorators, bigwigs, windbags, humbugs, pot-bellied, pot-boiling philosophers, professional Irishmen, men in love with stamps, men in love with steaks, men from the BBC, the British Broadcasting Corporation, who speak as if they had the Elgin marble in their mouth. See, too, in that linguacious stream, another variation on this last English type. And these are even better bred, even taller, with their upper-class moustaches and tusks, smelling of club armchairs and saddle soap, their breath a nice blend of whiskey and fox's blood, who've come to lecture America on the history of fly fishing in the Upper and Outer Hebrides. See to the brassy, bossy men, women with corrugated hair, self-announced as the ordinary British housewife, come to talk to rich, minked chunks of Yank matronhood about the iniquity of the British health service. Then again, there are the lecturers selling the British way of life and damning the American way as they swig and guzzle through it. The lecturers carrying on regardless in Boston about Etruscan pots and pans to a bunch of wealthy pots and dead pans. The lecturers resurrecting surrealisme to audiences who had not heard it was dead, not having ever heard it was alive. And finally, last and least, there in the sticky thick of orators on their way from one nest of culture vultures to another, there go the foreign poets, adenoidal troubadours, lyrical one-night standers, dollar-mad nightingales, remittance bards, myself among them, booming with the worst. Dylan Thomas as brilliant as he is unpredictable. A fat poet with a slim volume. Let's get back to you, this English novelist, on your tour. Do our trains cross, I wonder, you setting out from New York, me on my way back, you spry-eyed with a pair of clean, white, laundered lectures and a soul, me as dog-eared as my clutch of doggerel and typed impromptu asides. I'm sorry for me, but I ache for you. There you go in your Pullman pride, within your luggage a new dynamic personalized razor, guaranteed to operate at the flick of a thumb. Your first date happens to be a college one, run in conjunction with a women's club. And you are welcomed to the station by a crew-cut platoon of giant collegiates, all chasing the butterfly culture with net, notebook, and label, and each with at least 36 terribly white teeth. And off you are whisked, before you can say Gertrude Stein, in a giant automobile in which you stammer, in an over-British accent, good Lord, by Jove, don't you know, in which you stammer answers to such questions as, what international literary conference would at the moment be being attended by Stephen Spender? All this, mind you, calls for tact. You never know the minute. I think it was Sir Hugh Walpole who was met by the usual enormous car, driven this time by an enormous horn-rimmed businessman, and was settled into the back next to the businessman's wife, a furry, pearly, roly-poly. Oh, this is such a wonderful thrill for my committee. My, I never loved anything so much as your wonderful Sorrel and Son. Sir Hugh sat staring at the three double chins her husband wore at the back of his neck. They're all wonderful, but your best, basically, is that dreamy Sorrel and Son. A splendid book indeed, ventured Sir Hugh, but I'm afraid it was written by Warwick Deeping. Said the large, horn-rimmed husband at the wheel without turning, caught again, Carney. But back to you in your enormous car. Off you are whisked, before you can say Gertrude Stein, to a small party. Only a few hundred people, all holding the belief that what an English novelist needs before he trips onto the lecture platform is just enough dry martinis that he can trip off it as well. Of the lecture itself, you remember nothing except the applause. And perhaps two questions. Would it be true to say that the modern young British intellectual is basically psychosomatic? Or I invariably carry in my pocket the works of Kierkegaard. Who do you carry? And so it goes. And so it goes on and on and on, Ruth and breathlessly. And in between addresses and receptions, receptions and addresses, in trains and planes, planes and trains, and in boiling hotel bedroom ovens, you keep a diary. At first, unaccustomed to the importance which you are assumed by your hosts to possess, and slightly overawed by that importance, confused by profusion, jeopardized by generosity, and up against the barrier of a common language, at first you write in your diary like a didactic demon, generalizing to death about the American character, culture, customs, political climate, I may note, I may state, I must conclude, I must point out, refreshingly young country, stimulating audience, intoxicating skyline, they're like children playing with bricks, that octopus television, Babbitt, Davy Crockett, Dick Tracy, Macy, Ben Casey, I may note, I may state, I must conclude, I must point out, I. But towards the middle of your middle-aged whisk through Middle Western clubs, the fury of your frenzied phrase forming begins to flag, for you begin to notice that your stimulating audience will receive a lecture on Icelandic ceramics with the same uninhibited rapture which only last week they accorded to a paper on the modern Turkish novel. You begin to notice, too, that even the little miracles are not quite what was promised. In your boiling hotel bathroom oven, you find that the new dynamic razor, guaranteed to operate at the flick of a thumb, cuts that thumb to the bone, and that the blood can be staunched only by the services of two sneering bellboys. You cannot sleep, well, you dare not. For asleep, you are immediately chased through long, dark thickets of words by a Mrs. Maybelle Prinkerhoff Platt, with a basically elegiac triolet and a tray of basically dry martinis. And in your diary appear such entries as, no escape. I am beaten, or just Minneapolis. But all things come to an end, and quite suddenly, London bound at last, twitching all over from the ulcerous rigors of a lecturous spring, old before your time, your pockets full of cigars, sonnets, plastic pens, personalized paper matches, bottles of bourbon, ditto of benzedrine, telephone numbers, tranquilizers, your eyes like a pair of oysters Rockefeller in sand. You are helped up the gangway and down again back into the plush bowels of the Queen Mary. And so to bunk, back to sanity. Book society choice, quite enchanting, Elizabeth Bowen. Oh.
The Hunchback in the Park, a solitary mister, propped between trees and water from the opening of the garden lock that lets the trees and water enter until the Sunday somber bell at dark. Eating bread from a newspaper, drinking water from the chained cup that the children filled with gravel in the fountain basin where I sailed my ship. Slept at night in a dog kennel, but nobody chained him up. Like the park birds, he came early. Like the water, he sat down. And mister, they called. Hey, mister. The truant boys from the town, running when he had heard them clearly on, out of sound, past lake and rockery, laughing when he shook his back, hunchbacked in mockery, through the loud zoo of the willow groves, dodging the parkkeeper with his stick that picked up leaves. And the old dog sleeper, alone between nurses and swans, while the boys among willows made the tigers jump out of their eyes to roar on the rockery stones, and the groves were blue with sailors. Made all day until bell time, a woman figure without fault, straight as a young elm, straight and tall from its crooked bones, that she might stand in the night after the locks and chains, all night in the unmade park, after the railings and shrubberies, the birds, the grass, the trees, the lake, and the wild boys, innocent as strawberries, had followed the hunchback to his kennel in the dark. Now, as I was young and easy under the apple boughs, about the lilting house and happy as the grass was green, the night above the dingle starry, time let me hail and climb, golden in the heydays of his eyes. And honored among wagons, I was prince of the apple towns. And once below a time, I lordly had the trees and leaves trail with daisies and barley down the rivers of the windfall light. And as I was green and carefree, famous among the barns, about the happy yard and singing as the farm was home, in the sun that is young, once only. Time let me play and be golden in the mercy of his means. And green and golden I was huntsman and herdsman. The calves sang to my horn. The foxes on the hills barked clear and cold. And the Sabbath rang slowly in the pebbles of the holy streams. All the sun long it was running, it was lovely, the hay fields high as the house. The tunes from the chimneys, it was air and playing, lovely and watery and fire, green as grass. And nightly, as I rode to sleep, the owls were bearing the farm away. All the moon long I heard, blessed among stables, the nightjars flying with the ricks, and the horses flashing into the dark. And then, to awake, the farm, like a wanderer, white with the dew, come back, the cock on his shoulder. It was all shining. It was Adam and maiden. The sky gathered again, and the sun grew round that very day. So it must have been after the birth of the simple light, in the first spinning place, the spellbound horses walking warm out of the whinnying green stable onto the fields of praise. And honored among foxes and pheasants by the gay house, under the new-made clouds, and happy as the heart was long, in the sun born over and over, I ran my heedless ways. My wishes raced through the house, high hay, and nothing I cared at my sky-blue trades that time allows in all his tuneful turnings, so few and such morning songs, before the children green and golden follow him out of grace. And nothing I cared in the lamb-white days that time would take me up to the swallow-thronged loft by the shadow of my hand, nor that riding to sleep I should wake to hear the farm forever fled from the childless land. Oh, as I was green and carefree, in the mercy of his means, time held me green and dying. though I sang in my chains, like the sea.
Lord Cutglass, in his kitchen full of time, squats down alone to a dog dish marked Fido of peppery fish scraps and listens to the voices of his 66 clocks, one for each year of his loony age, and watches with love their black and white moony loud-lipped faces talking the earth away. Slow clocks, quick clocks, pendulumed heart knocks, china, alarm, grandfather, cuckoo, clocks shaped like Noah's whirring ark, clocks that bicker in marble ships, clocks in the wombs of glass women, hourglass chimers, to-wit-to-woo clocks, clocks that pluck tunes, Vesuvius clocks, all black bells and lava, Niagara clocks that cataract their ticks, old time-weeping clocks with ebony beards, clocks with no hands forever drumming out time without ever knowing what time it is. His 66 singers are all set at different hours. Lord Cutglass lives in a house and a life at siege. Any minute or dark day now, the unknown enemy will loot and savage downhill. But they will not catch him napping. 66 different times in his fish slimy kitchen, ping, strike, tick, chime, and tock.
The lust and lilt and lather and emerald breeze and crackle of the bird preys and body of spring, with its breasts full of rivering May milk, means to that lordly fish-head nibbler nothing but another nearness to the tribes and navies of the last black day, who'll sear and pillage down Armageddon Hill to his double-locked, rusty-shuttered, tick-tock, dust-scrabbled shack at the bottom of the town that has fallen head over bells in love.
And I'll never have such loving again.
Pretty Polly hums and longs.
Now when farmers' boys on the first fair day come down from the hills to drink and be gay, before the sun sinks, I'll lie there in their arms. For they're good bad boys from the lonely farms. But I always think, as we tumble into bed, of little Willy Wee, who is dead, dead, dead.
The sunny, slow, lulling afternoon yawns and moons through the dozy town. The sea lolls, laps, and idles in with fishes sleeping in its lap. The meadows, still as Sunday, the shut-eye tasseled bulls, the goat and daisy dingles nap happy and lazy. The dumb duck ponds snooze. Clouds sag and pillow on Llareggib Hill. Pigs grunt in a wet wallow bath and smile as they snort and dream. They dream of the acorn swill of the world, the rooting for pigfruit, the bagpipe dugs of the mother sow, the squeal and snuffle of yeses of the women pigs in rut. They mud bask and snout in the pig-loving sun. Their tails curl. They rollick and slobber and snore to deep, smug, after-swill sleep. Donkeys angelically drowse on Donkey Down.
Persons with manners,
snaps Mrs. Cole Pew.
Do not nod the table.
Mr. Pew cringes awake. He puts on a soft, soaping smile. It is sad and grey under his nicotine, egg-yellow, weeping, walrus, Victorian moustache, worn thick and long, in memory of Dr. Crippen.
You should wait until you retire to your sty,
says Mrs. Pew, sweet as a razor. His fawning, measly quarter-smile freezes. Sly and silent, he foxes into his chemist's den, and there, in a hiss and prussic circle of cauldrons and phials, brimful with pox and the Black Death, cooks up a fricassee of deadly nightshade, nicotine, hot frog, cyanide and batspit for his needling, stalactite hag and bednag of a poker-backed nutcracker wife.
I beg your pardon, my dear,
he murmurs with a wheedle.
Captain Cat, at his window thrown wide to the sun,
and the clippered seas he sailed long ago when his eyes were blue and bright. Slumbers and voyages, ear-ringed and rolling, I love you, Rosie Probert, tattooed on his belly. He brawls with broken bottles in the fug and babel of the dark dock bars, roves with a herd of short and good-time cows in every naughty port, and twines and souses with the drowned and blowsy-breasted dead. He weeps as he sleeps and sails.
One voice of all he remembers most dearly as his dream buckets down. Lazy early Rosie with the flaxen thatch, whom he shared with Tom Fred the donkey man and many another seaman. Clearly and near to him speaks from the bedroom of her dust. In that gulf and haven, fleets by the dozen have anchored for the little heaven of the night. But she speaks to Captain Napping Cat alone. Mrs. Probert.
From Duck Lane, Jack. Quack twice and ask for Rosie.
Is the one love of his sea life that was sardined with women.
What seas did you see, Tomcat, Tomcat, in your sailoring days, long, long ago? What sea beasts were in the wavery green when you were my master?
I'll tell you the truth. Seas barking like seals, blue seas and green, seas covered with eels and mermen and whales.
What seas did you sail, old whaler, when on the blubbery waves between Frisco and Wales, you are my bosun?
As true as I'm here, dear you tomcat start, you landlubber Rosie, you cozy love, my easy as easy, my true sweetheart. Seas green as a bean, seas gliding with swans in the seal barking moon.
What seas were rocking, my little deckhand, my favorite husband, in your sea boots and hunger, my duck, my whaler? My honey, my daddy, my pretty sugar sailor, with my name on your belly, when you were a boy, long, long ago.
I'll tell you no lies. The only sea I saw was the seesaw sea with you riding on it. Lie down, lie easy. Let me shipwreck in your thighs.
Knock twice, Jack, at the door of my grave and ask for Rosie.
Rosie Probert.
Remember her. She is forgetting. The earth which filled her mouth is vanishing from her. Remember me. I have forgotten you. I am going into the darkness of the darkness forever. I have forgotten that I was ever born.
And death shall have no dominion. Dead men naked, they shall be one with a man in the wind and the west moon. When their bones are picked clean and the clean bones gone, they shall have stars at elbow and foot. Though they go mad, they shall be sane. Though they sink through the sea, they shall rise again. Though lovers be lost, love shall not. And death shall have no dominion. And death shall have no dominion under the windings of the sea. They lying long shall not die windily, twisting on racks when sinews give way, strapped to a wheel, yet they shall not break. Faith in their hands shall snap in two, and the unicorn evils run them through, split all ends up, they shan't crack. And death shall have no dominion. And death shall have no dominion. No more may gulls cry at their ears, or waves break loud on the seashores. Where blue a flower, may a flower no more lift lift its head to the blows of the rain. Though they be mad and dead as nails, heads of the characters hammer through daisies, break in the sun till the sun breaks down, and death shall have no dominion.